I couldn't even look at the pictures coming out of Syria with the sarin gas. I had to turn away. I couldn't flip the channel. That's just too much to see what man would do to another man, let alone little children in a village. Death should affect us, right? I can't even take the death of a chipmunk on the road. They are the dumbest things I have ever seen in my entire life. They sit right in the middle of the road. And there's nothing there. I don't even know what they're looking for. They just sit in the middle of the road. And then you try to... I'm not going to wreck my car for a little chipmunk because they're going to die anyway. They're so stupid. Someone's going to eventually hit them. But I can't even bear the death of one of those little chipmunks. Let alone a human being perish. With the onslaught of news in our country and the 24/7 newscasts, it has led us to lose much of our innocence when it comes to death, right? It has given us, all of us, to some degree, a little coldness, a little hardness to death, because we see it so often. Imagine having a job where you have to deal with death on a regular basis. In my line of business, I meet a lot of morticians. I would not want their job. I can't imagine that, having to deal with that. Or a police officer or a fireman in a town, not unlike our own in Warriors Mart, but in another town where death is regular. Can you imagine being a police officer in Chicago, Philadelphia, or Camden? Being EMTs, and some of you here today are medical professionals. I mean, it's difficult to deal with death. Dear ladies who work in critical care and hospice care, some of you, I know you do, and it's difficult. I can't imagine having to deal with death, and death is always looming over your head day by day. Today we're going to consider a man who could easily have been cold-hearted to death. Turn to Mark chapter 15. Mark chapter 15. We've already read a little bit about him, but we'll read again about him in Mark. Turn to Mark 15, verse 22. As we consider the life of the centurion. Mark 15, 22. And they bring him onto the place Golgotha, which is being interpreted the place of the skull. And there they gave him to drink wine mingled with myrrh, but he received it not. And when they had crucified him, they parted his garments, casting lots upon them what every man should take. And it was the third hour, and they crucified him. And the superscription of his accusation was written over him, "The King of the Jews." And with him they crucified two thieves, the one on his right hand and the other on his left. And the scripture was fulfilled, which saith, "He was numbered with the transgressors." And they that passed by railed on him, wagging their heads and saying, "Ah, thou that destroyest the temple and buildest in 3 days, save thyself and come down from the cross." Likewise also the chief priests mocking said among themselves with the scribes, "He saved others, himself he cannot save. Let the Christ, the King of Israel, descend now from the cross, that we may see and believe." And they that were crucified with him reviled him. And when the sixth hour was come, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which is in being interpreted, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" And some of them that stood by, when they heard it, said, "Behold, he crieth for Elijah." And one ran and filled a sponge full of vinegar and put it on a reed and gave it him to drink, saying, "Let him alone, let us see whether Elijah will come to take him down." And Jesus cried with a loud voice, and he gave up the ghost. And the veil of the temple was rent in two from the top to the bottom. And when the centurion, which stood over against him, saw that he so cried out and gave up the ghost, he said, "Truly, this man was the Son of God." There were also women looking on afar off, among whom were Mary Magdalene, and Mary the mother of James the Less, and of Joses, and Salome, who also, when he was in Galilee, followed him and ministered unto him, and many other women which came up from him to Jerusalem. For this year's Passion Week messages, I've been taking a pointed look at the cross from three different perspectives. On Good Friday, on Friday night, we looked at Mary of Bethany and her testimony. As she looked forward, and her viewpoint was, it was forward in time for her. And we looked at her perspective and also her response, which was to anoint the body of Jesus Christ and his feet for burial. And we also looked at Judas Iscariot, who, like many of us, is oblivious to things that go on in life. And he missed everything that Jesus said and did. And ultimately, it cost him his life and eternity. Today, now, we're going to take the present perspective. We're going to consider someone who is actually there. At the moment, he saw what happened on the cross. He saw all the events from start to finish. He was there. So we're going to look at his perspective on the cross for those 6 hours. In this perspective, we will focus primarily on the centurion, but I want you to also consider the onlookers, the various onlookers, and we'll just briefly mention them. And then later this morning, we're going to take the backward perspective. That's our perspective. We're going to look back at the cross, what it means. What does the cross mean to you and I? What does the cross and the resurrection, what should its impact be upon us? And should we identify with it? Should we live in the shadow of that cross? The centurion. This poor man, who became a fortunate man, had the duty of being in charge of a band of some 100 Roman soldiers. His particular responsibility was to carry out capital crimes. And in that society, the process didn't last 47 years until they carried out a capital crime. When someone was committed to a capital crime, they handed him over to the centurion. Small band of his men, usually about two to four, and they would carry out, in this case, the governor's wishes, who was at this time Pontius Pilate in the province of Judea. This day, like many other days, meant that they would have to bear their crossbeam, they would need to carry it up, they would need to nail the criminals to the cross. Today there were three, and we know it, two are deserving, and one is innocent. He probably had done this job many times before. With cold precision, he once again performs his duties. He strips them first. And then he asks his men to hammer those spikes into their wrists as they hung on that crossbeam. And then they would nail another large spike in their legs on the other beam, the cross, and form a cross. And then they would raise the person up. Let them die, baking in the sun. After nailing Jesus and the other two to their crosses, the soldiers settled down to their usual ritual that they knew all too well. They took it as a time to take whatever possessions those criminals had and name them for their own, right? Kind of reminds me of Scrooge when he died, right? And they came and stripped all his stuff out and took whatever few goods that he had left and claimed it for their own, the workers, right? It was time for a little gambling, a little reaping of the spoils from these three. Slim pickings for these guys, though, right? In the case of Jesus, just two garments. That's all he had. Two garments. The one wasn't worth much except for the cloth, so they rip it in four parts and share that. The other was a seamless garment, worth a little bit more. Of wool, most likely, because he was a Hebrew, multicolored. That they would cast lots for. That they would gamble for. And the centurion sits on and watches on as his men do their normal and just dismisses it. What can I do? Little did anyone know what this day had held in store for them at this moment, right? None of them knew. It was, however, a day that no one would ever be able to forget that was there. Because it was the day that Christ died. This day he would witness was no ordinary death, which he's seen countless other times. He's presided over so many deaths, but this one would impact him for eternity. The centurion, you notice as I read that, was the closest to the scene. Look at verse 15:39 again. The centurion stood over against him. And you can picture this as he's right. If the three are up on the cross, he's like in the middle of one and two, or two and three. I don't know which one it would have been. But he's standing right there, making sure there's no funny business from the crowd, right? Making sure that none of those poor women or one, at least one scared disciple in the person of John would come and take him down, right? Not going to happen when the centurion's standing there with a sword in his hand. I mean, a sword in a sheath and a spear in his hand, right? It's not going to happen. That's his position. But it's a unique position because he could do what? He could hear everything that was said, both from the three that were up there and from the crowd. His vantage point was the front row seat of the events of the day, and he hears the words of Christ in response to the godless acts of his enemies. He hears the mockings of the people, priests and the scribes and the rulers. He hears their derision and their sarcasm, their scoffing, their anger and contempt. Yet he hears Christ say what? Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. He hears their anger and their frustration with him. But yet, he also sees their ignorance of his divinity and the purpose for his coming. They demand signs. Give us a sign. Give us a sign to the end that you are who you say you are, the Messiah, the Son of God. But he doesn't heed them, does he? What if Christ would have heeded their demands and gave in? You and I wouldn't be here today, right? There would be no empty tomb. There would be no sacrifice for sin. No, he doesn't come off the cross. Rather, he follows through with the Father's will. They demand a display of his power. He chooses rather to display his love and his mercy and his forgiveness. So he remains on the cross, bearing their sins, bearing your sins and mine. You see, their miscalculation of him was a consistent, long misunderstanding of Scripture, isn't it? Those of us on Wednesday night, we've been looking through this over and over again. I can't count the number of times how they miscalculate him. And now they miscalculate him on the cross. And they misunderstand the Scriptures, which clearly spoke that he must suffer. And he must suffer at their hands. And he must die. And he must be buried. And praise the Lord, he must rise again the third day. They wanted him to save his life, but they failed to understand his mission and God's purpose for bruising his son. And that is that the Son of God did not come to save his own life, but ours. Next, he witnesses cataclysmic events. His silence of the Savior, his gentleness, he looks upon that. He sees that, the centurion. He also sees his goodness displayed in the depths of his despair toward his enemies. And as the day goes on, the turmoil of his soul increases as he witnesses great signs from the throne of heaven. Can you imagine what he saw and heard? He saw darkness. And I mean darkness. We get thunderstorms around here, right? But this mentions that the sun was blotted out by God. It's as if God put his hand upon it. Now, we could all sit here and do what we think may have happened, whether it was a total eclipse, solar eclipse. In a sense, yes, that kind of darkness. But whatever it was, I'm not gonna go with all the scientific stuff. It was a miracle. It's now midday. It is noon. High sun. It is the third hour. It says the sixth hour, which in Roman time, sixth hour from the Jewish perspective is noon. And from the sixth hour to the ninth hour, from noon to three, they see darkness. But if that's not enough, what happens? The earth begins to quake. It's shaken. Which is not necessarily uncommon in Jerusalem, but the darkness along with the earthquake and rocks beginning to be put in two, large rocks become two rocks and four rocks and eight rocks. Begins to happen. The fear and the awe that these cataclysmic events created a great sense of respect for God's power in this man. And it altered his perspective on the events of the crucifixion of this, the Son of God. See, this was no ordinary day, was it? It was the day that Jesus died. A centurion was alleged to be a man of strength and of great power, but now he is greatly humbled by a power that far exceeds his own, the emperor who he serves, and in the great Roman legions in which he is part of. The centurion now perceives that even though he is dying, this man has great power. And that there is great power in Jesus Christ as he rests on his cross. Notice their response. First, the centurions, the man we are considering. He sees him, he sees these events, and he hears Christ cry up, and he gave up the ghost. He didn't die like any other man, right? He willingly lays down his life. I've been with people who knew it was the day they were going to die, right? We've all somewhat experienced or heard of that. But he actually lets go of his spirit and dies. To the centurion, he's never seen something like this. He has witnessed many deaths. Death was routine for him, but not this death. The untold agony that he experienced, yet the kindness and the power mixed together and the ability to let the last breath go and give up his ghost. It left this man wondering, pondering, who is this man? Who is this man? His response, according to Luke, turn to Luke 23:47, was first to worship him. Luke 23:47 says this, "Now when the centurion saw what was done, he glorified God. He worshiped him, saying, certainly this was a righteous man." So that's his first response. He worships, glorifies him, and then he says he was a righteous man. He is completely convinced that this man was innocent and that he did not die for his own sins, but the sins of those that were watching that day, including himself. He is a righteous man. I am an unrighteous man. He truly is the Son of God. That's quite an admission when you think about that. For a Roman Gentile to say, He is the king. Not just the king of the Jews, but the king of the whole world. In fact, the whole universe for that matter. He is the Messiah. This Christ who these Jews say, yes, he is the Son of God, the Savior of the world. The centurion's response is the right one, the one of faith, and should be the response of faith that the gospel and the cross demands for each and every person here today and to whomever we reach out to. That is the right response. is the Son of God. I will worship him. I will praise him. I will humble myself before him. The power of the cross and of Christ and the suffering of Christ upon Calvary's cross should produce faith, and it should produce an unforgettable life-altering event in our lives, right? You can't get over this one. If you're saved, now it's not something you may think about all the time, but it is an unforgettable, altering life event when you come to the cross, to the foot of it. That's true faith. It is a life-changing faith. He still had the task of making sure he was actually dead. See, remember, he still has a job to do. He has claimed and he has worshiped and he has humbled himself, but he still lives as a soldier under Pilate's care and Tiberius's care. So he has to make sure he's actually dead. Turn to Mark 15:44. And Pilate marveled. He goes in. Here's everyone coming together. Joseph of Arimathea comes in. Pilate and all the religious leaders and chief priests are together. Isn't it amazing they can gather together after what they just did? But they had no problem with that. And they're all sitting in there pondering what they can do next. And Pilate marveled if he were already dead. You tell me he's already dead, Joseph? Yes, he's dead. After 6 quick hours like that, not normal, right? So he calls in the centurion, and he asks him whether he had been already dead. And when he knew it of the centurion, he gave the body to Joseph. So here we see the confirmation of it. Turn to John. We should see the process of it. John 19. In verse 31. The Jews, here we see the complete hypocrisy of these people. The Jews, therefore, because it was the preparation day, it's the day before the Sabbath, and we can't let those bodies be up there when we start the Sabbath. They had no problem with putting him to death, right? And asking for a murderer and an insurrectionist in his place. They had no problem with that, but yet, please take him off that cross because our Sabbath is about to begin. It's now between 3 and 6 p.m. That the body should not remain upon the cross on the Sabbath day, for the Sabbath day was a high day. Yep, it's the start of the Feast of the Unleavened Bread. They besought Pilate that the legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. So to hasten death, they would break the legs of the people, of the men that were on there, because they could no longer lift themselves up to breathe. Therefore, they would die of what normally is the case with the cross, asphyxiation. Then came the soldiers. And they break the legs of the first and the other, which was crucified with him. So the first and the third, they break the legs. But when they come to Jesus and saw that he was dead already, they didn't break his legs. But one of the soldiers, which under the command of the centurion, took his spear. And he pierced his side. And forthwith came there one out blood and water, signifying, those of you in the medical profession, that he was actually dead. Physically dead. So he knows that. So this final task he has to do. And he reports back to Pontius Pilate that he is truly dead. I wonder what the centurion was thinking when of what he just witnessed. I wonder if he was saying, yeah, he's dead, but I know he's alive. I know he's alive because he's the Son of God. There are others there. Turn to Luke 23. Remember the others that were there? 23:48. Look what Luke says in Luke 23:48. And all the people that came together to that site, beholding the things which were done, smote their breasts and returned. The unfolding of the events of the cross had an alarming effect upon others at the cross also. It says all, not just the women who loved him and thought that he was the Son of God, and who in their hearts are thinking all their hopes are now dashed. But we know 3 days later that's not the case. But the scoffers too. The mockers, the unbelievers. Some were true followers and believers in Jesus Christ, like the women and John. How did they leave? How did those last 6 hours affect them? Well, Scripture says they left beating their breasts. There was this deep guilt and shame for their actions. Their pride turns to humility and remorse. A sense of woe overwhelms them emotionally. Sarcasm and mocking quickly changes as they just realize something. He is who he said he is. And we killed him. He is who he says he is. He is the one who bore their sins. He is the one who carried away their transgressions and their griefs and their sorrows. He was the one who just made intercession and sacrifice for them. And oh, woe is to us because we just put him to death. Once again, we see the power of the cross that can change the coldest of hearts. If one just takes the time to gaze upon it. Once again, we see that the cross and the grace of God can change the most irreligious of people, the most vilest of souls, the most wretched of all sinners, a Roman centurion. Just like the thief on the cross. In a moment it all changes for life and eternity. That gives me great encouragement. Doesn't it give you great encouragement? Gives me great encouragement for my lost family members, my friends, and my neighbors, and my, former co-workers, your co-workers. It gives me hope that the cross can change anybody. The most adamant of atheists, the most wicked politicians, that you may curse under your breath. There's hope for them this day. There's hope because the cross gives great hope, doesn't it? The power of Christ and his cross and his gospel can change anyone. And the mercy of God is never strained by any event that happens in this world. God in his mercy, he allows a centurion to be there that day. He allowed it to be the day that that thief, who's now in paradise, it would be his day to die there. Of all the others who have died on the cross at the hands of these Romans, that one lucky man, that one very fortunate centurion who got to stand by, who got the front row seat, it was because of God's mercy for him. He got to see the events of the cross that day, the day that Jesus died. And the result was life transforming for the centurion. Let's pray. Father, thank you again for your grace. Lord, I pray that you will just guide us this day in your mercies. Lord, help us again to ponder the cross and its our response to it. May it be pleasing in your sight, for it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Tim's going to come lead a song. We have a nursing piano player.
Hymn 589. Please stand if you're able. To get ready for the pianist. 589. Pardon?
It's in the book.
It's in the book.
Just seeing the notes.
Here she comes. 589, we'll sing all three verses.
Marvelous message we bring, glorious carols.
express how much we love you and we thank you for your son, Jesus Christ, and his death, burial, and most importantly for us, his resurrection, Lord. And we just pray you'll help us to remember that and live it each and every day, not just once a year, but every day of our lives. We thank you for those that could be here. Ask you to be with each one, Lord, and work in our hearts and lives. And pray for those that can't be here, Lord. We lift them to you. We thank you now, Lord, for the food we're about to receive. We ask you to bless it. Bless it. The hands that have prepared it, Lord, we just ask you to use it to strengthen our bodies and be with us the remainder of this day, Lord. And we pray that all we do